I want to just go ahead and get started, jump in. And yeah, it's going to be a bit of a long one, but hopefully very helpful for you all. So welcome this morning to the Human Services Grant Application Workshop for the FTA 5310 Grant Program. My name's Jess Maffey. I'm the Transit Programs Manager for the Virginia Department of Rail and Public Transportation, and I manage the 5310 program. And today's webinar is intended to give an introduction to the 5310 program and discuss the upcoming application cycle. And I'm going to the next slide, and I just want to note that if you cannot see the slides changing, please use the advanced slides option on your screen to follow along. So that will be somewhere underneath the presentation. I know some folks who have been on these webinars know that sometimes you can't see the slides as we change them. So I'll make sure to note when I change slides. All right, so just a bit of housekeeping to get us started. All attendees are currently muted. And I have Miriam here from our comms team who is letting people in. And she'll help deal with any technical issues. You can put those in the chat if you're having issues. But otherwise, we're going to, you know, go along. And if you need something, you can raise your hand using the raise hand feature. And we'll call on you to unmute. But otherwise, go ahead and put things in the chat for us for the most part. So you know, this webinar is being recorded, and the recording and the slides will be sent out after this webinar this week. And all the materials that are linked in these slides will be available to you. Questions will be answered at the end of each major agenda section and at the end of the webinar. Like I said, if you'll just use that chat feature to ask questions if you have them throughout, or when we get to that questions section, you can use the raise hand feature if you'd like to unmute. But if you keep things in the chat, that will probably likely keep us straight. Just because, again, there's a lot of information we're covering today. And as I said, for anyone who just came in, if you can't see the slides as I'm changing them, you should have an option at the bottom of your screen to advance the slides with me, and I'll indicate as I change each slide. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the next slide, slide 3. Our first announcement, which I very much hope most of you are aware of, is that Olga is no longer, or is going to no longer be DRPT's online grants management system starting November 15th. Everything will be transferred over to a program called Web Grants, with very few exceptions in terms of our processes. And Web Grants will open to applicants on December 1st for this year's grant cycle. I just wanted to note here that our capital vehicle recipients will continue to use TransAm for your vehicle inventory. So that program is not going away. And we will talk about that briefly in this presentation. And the other thing I just wanted to note for this presentation is I'm going to focus on information and materials you need for this year's 5310 application. And I'm not going to address grant management as much. However, everyone, you know, if you're applying to this program, you should still familiarize yourself with what will be required of you if you're awarded. And that's all going to be available in the grant application and management guidance, which it will be linked or is linked on the next slide. So I'm going to go ahead and go to slide 4. So this is just a list of the materials I'm going to reference in this presentation. Again, you will receive these slides. So you'll get all this information and these links so you can reference these after the presentation. I will have, like you see here, the questions are not there yet. The budget template's not there yet. Those will be linked when I send this out, so don't worry about that. But you will receive those questions, which have not changed significantly from previous years. But just wanted to let you know this will all be here for you. All right, I'm going to head on to the next slide, slide 5. For today's agenda, we're going to go over the FTA Section 5310 program broadly, just so you get an idea for anyone new to this program or anyone new to their position, really what this grant is all about. We're then going to go straight into a web grants overview and application demo. So I really want you guys to start feeling comfortable with the new system. And right now, obviously, it's not in production. It's opening on December 1st, but I'm going to show you it in our test environment so you just get to see kind of what it looks like and what we're going to what you're going to be doing in there. After I go through that demo, then I'm going to kind of go into the more traditional part of this presentation, which is going through the application, including performance reporting requirements. And then I'll go into each specific grant program, which includes the capital vehicle program, other capital mobility management, the operating program. Then I'll give a brief sort of summary of what I'm looking for with your line item budgets if you're applying to operating or other capital. And then we'll have a final Q&A. But again, for anyone coming in, if you have questions as we go along, please put them in the chat. I've got another DRPT employee here who can help with any technical assistance if you're having issues. So I'm going to go ahead to slide number 6. So let's go ahead and go over the FTA Section 5310 program. And again, just as a reminder, the guidance is available and posted online and in this presentation. So you're going to see a lot of information on these slides. And hopefully this will just serve as a resource for you after this presentation. So I apologize that it's not as maybe pretty or filled with pictures as I would prefer it to be. So the FTA Section 5310 program, to just go over a quick overview, it is a federal grant that is given through the Federal Transit Administration, or FTA, and administered by DRPT. The program intent is to improve mobility for seniors, defined as people 65 years of age and older, and individuals with disabilities, by removing barriers to transportation and expanding the available transportation options. The eligible activities under this program are for capital and operating expenses to support the provision of transportation services to meet the specific needs of seniors and individuals with disabilities. And finally, eligible applicants for this program are private nonprofit organizations, state or local governments that are approved by the state to coordinate services for these populations, or that can certify there are no nonprofits readily available in the area to provide the service. And public transportation operators are also eligible to apply. And I just want to note that you see this eligible population appear all over the place. This, again, is kind of a very key part of this program and something that trickles down into every aspect of this application. So you'll hear a lot about that. And just a note, when we say removing barriers to service or expanding available transportation options, barriers could mean the cost of a service. So a program might be a voucher program that, you know, helps remove that barrier that's cost. And it could also solve lack of transportation in a community by creating a completely new service. So that, you know, when we start to think about what these words mean, that's sort of the project types we're starting to talk about here. Something that's important to understand about the 5310 program, and again, this is sort of high level and what we at DRPT are kind of looking at when we're looking at applications and thinking about funding. It's important to understand that funding for the 5310 program is apportioned by the FTA, and it's given to DRPT as a direct recipient, and then DRPT awards subrecipients through a competitive discretionary grant process. So the funding, the funds are given to DRPT annually for three different areas, and the funding is determined by essentially the census. So the amount of people who are seniors or individuals with disability, that's how, you know, from a federal level down to the state, they determine how much funding we get as a whole. And then from that, or out of that overall funding, it is further divided into funding for rural areas, small urbanized areas, and large urbanized areas. So you can see rural gets 20% of our apportionment, small urbanized gets 20% of the apportionment, and then large urbanized gets 60% of that apportionment. And just to note here that Northern Virginia is the direct recipient for, the Metropolitan Washington Council of Governments, or MWCOG, is the recipient for Northern Virginia. So DRPT and this program covers all of Virginia except this, you know, kind of Northern Virginia area around DC. So the of each area's apportionment, DRPT has to spend at least 55% on what 55% of the funding on what the FTA calls traditional capital, such as accessible vehicles. That is at least 55% that must be spent on capital projects. So we can go more than 55%, but we have to expend that amount on capital. And I actually wrote, I've put some language here from the 5310 circular, just to kind of spell this out further. So what the FTA is looking for is that we have to use it for public transportation capital projects that are planned, designed, and carried out to meet the specific needs of seniors and individuals with disabilities. And it's not sufficient that these populations are merely included or assumed to be included among the people who will benefit from the project. So this is just emphasizing again that these projects are, you know, it's not just the general public, it's really these populations who are being provided public transportation. All right, we'll move on from that. So this part, I want to get into the applicant requirements. And this is kind of, again, at a high level, like when you're thinking about whether you want to apply, or if you're eligible to apply, or if your organization, you know, needs to put some things in place before you apply, this should just kind of give you a good idea for this. So the applicant submitting the application must be the organization that will ultimately receive the funding or vehicles. So applications may not be submitted by one organization to support funding or vehicle needs at another organization. The applicant awardee or organization that executes the funding agreement and the titled vehicle owner must all be the same agency. This does not prevent one agency from contracting or purchasing service from another, but the contracting process must meet the FTA's requirements under this program. So I note this because in the past, there was pass-through funding allowed so that some organizations could apply on behalf of others. But this is no longer the case. It hasn't been the case now for a couple years. So agencies that have historically received 5310 vehicles or funding through another agency will need to establish their own web grants accounts to continue seeking support through DRPT. So I just want to emphasize this. I know a lot of you have already dealt with this or know what's going on, but just want to note this again for anyone new or is not sure that, you know, you will have to have your own account and apply separately. And again, I'm going to get more into web grants here and about how that will work in this system. Another requirement is coordination. So this program requires coordination to maximize federal dollars. At a basic level, DRPT expects programs to coordinate with each other and not duplicate services in an area. We also expect ongoing community level coordination, which is detailed in the Coordinated Human Service Mobility Plan, or CHISM plan. So just to briefly touch on the CHISM plan, I know a lot of you participate in the CHISM plan meetings, but just to touch on it here, the CHISM plan is a requirement of the 5310 program, as in the FTA requires us at DRPT to create this CHISM plan. And it lays out Virginia's goals and priorities for transportation to these populations over the next 3 years. So the most recent plan, which is 2022, is available on the website. And it's on that one of those early slides I showed, the plan itself, as well as a story map version of the plan. And the notable thing here for the application is that when you're completing your application, There will be questions relevant to the Chisholm plan, and you'll need to tie your program to the action tracker items in the Chisholm plan. So there's a number of statewide and regional recommendations in that section, and you'll need to choose one or more of those that your program aligns with. So again, I know many of you participate in the Chisholm plan meeting, so I'm not going to rehash this too much, but if anyone has questions about that, you can reach out to me and I can send you some more resources. Another note about the Chisholm plan, your participation in those Chisholm regional meetings does count toward points on your application. And if you did not attend those meetings this year, reach out to me and let me know if this is your first time hearing about this, or if you're not sure if your agency attended, just contact me and we can discuss that. Another applicant requirement that I just want to note is that if your agency is providing rides that are funded through Medicaid or Medicare, you must be able to prove that your agency is separating out other federally funded trips from 5310 funded trips. So this is just something to think about if you're applying, that, you know, we'll need to be able to show that you're not, you know, we know you wouldn't want to do this on purpose, but double dipping on federal funding to fund or, you know, trips for this program. So that's just something to think about, again, if you're kind of thinking about how this will function within your organization. Another applicant requirement is that you must develop and implement Title VI and ADA. So all 5310 programs are required to have a Title VI plan that's approved by DRPT and covers at least the current grant year. So if you are a program that doesn't have a Title VI plan, we can work with you and we have resources available to help you develop that plan. But otherwise, for past programs, if you have one that's developed, just you need to make sure it's updated and signed, and that will be submitted as with the application as an attachment. You also must have ADA policies and procedures in place, including a complaint process. These materials are also required to be posted on your agency's websites and in physical, like, common areas of your agency. So again, this is just something to think about if you're applying and you're not sure whether your agency has these, or you know that you don't have them and you're going to have to create them. We don't require that, you know, you have to have an approved plan in place when you apply, but we do have you attach like a letter of intent to say, yes, we're going to put this in place. So just want to note that as something to think about again for your application. All right, I'm going to check the chat for any questions so far. Feel free to put anything in there. Let's see. Okay. So Jordanette said we were told rural areas were not allocated capital funds for vehicles. Will that be the case moving forward with this application process? No. So it may have been that we did not have enough funding last year to fund all vehicles requests in rural areas. That's usually the case, but there is definitely capital funding in rural areas. And Jen, let's see, AAs serve older adults 60 plus. In the past, individuals between 60 and 65 years old could be served. Yes, Jen. So that is something that, you know, is a continual source of a little bit of tension or uncertainty between like the FTA and other organizations, how they define seniors. So basically, you know, individuals with disabilities is considered a pretty broad category. So essentially, yes, we're considering 60 plus in this category, but, you know, just want to make sure that you're kind of falling into either of those eligible populations, if that makes sense. Okay, I'm going to continue to move on just to keep this going. I'm going to go right ahead and go into a demo of our web grants application. So let me pull this up for you all. Just a moment. Okay. Miriam, can you indicate whether, or can anyone indicate whether they can see my screen with the Web Grants login? Okay, I'm seeing yes, yes. Michelle, I will get to your question later in the presentation. Thank you. Okay, so this is what the login screen is going to look at like when you go to Web Grants. I want to note that this is a test environment that I'm going into right now. So this is not production. We are currently in a test environment ourselves, DRPT. So it will look a little bit different on the inside. But I just wanted to, again, give you kind of an overview and the flavor of what this is going to look like. So I'm going to go ahead and sign in with my test account. I'm going to sign in. And so this is basically what's going to pop up when you log into Web Grants. You'll kind of see your name up here in the corner, and you'll see your role. You can't see it right here, but it says I'm an external user, which all of you will be external users. And just want to note real quick that when you log in, you'll kind of see your dashboard. And you'll be able to actually see notifications about any approaching deadlines and some other options here where we'll be communicating things to you through your dashboard. So this is kind of nice because once you log in, you'll immediately kind of be able to see any tasks that you need to complete. And I'm not going over registration that much or anything right now. Again, I just need to focus on the application. There'll be a lot more training about specifically how you're going to register and what that will look like. So next, I just wanted to quickly go in and show you this My Profile. So when you go into your profile, this is going to be actually your personal contact information that you'll log in with. So, you know, your name, your organization email. And this is something that, you know, you'll be able to edit. This is just what you fill out when you register or what will be transferred over from Olga if you're the master user. And I just wanted to go down and you can kind of see here, again, this is the test environment. There might be instructions or some other sort of things in these blue boxes. And you can see here at the bottom under associate organizations, this is where you're going to be able to see the organization that your user account is associated with. So this user account is associated with the external test user organization, which, you know, this would be your organization name. And then you'll be able to see some basic information about your organization. So I just wanted to point this out because this is not something you'll be filling out in your application. It's going to just be attached to your app. It's going to be attached already to your application because you're going to be applying as your organization. Also under this organization, just scrolling down, you can see who's going to be associated with your organization. So you'll be able to see other users. And as we sort of talked about earlier this week, if you were in the Web Grants meetings, you'll have the ability to add more users to your account as well. So if you need someone else to get in there and help you work on the application, you'll actually be able to add them yourselves. All right, I'm not going to get into more detail on this right now. Again, there'll be more training coming out. I just kind of wanted to show you this portion, but I wanted to get into the key piece here, which is the funding opportunities. So the way that the applications are organized now is that each project area has a funding opportunity. So for 5310, and I'm just going to show you right now, you're seeing all of our funding opportunities. You will likely only see the transit programs, not the rail, when you log in. But I'm going up here and I'm just organizing this by title. So this will be kind of a nice option for you. But basically, you can see here, there we go. Right here, we got 5310. So each of the program areas has a funding opportunity. So we have capital vehicles, operating, and other capital. Now, as many of you know, things have changed back and forth over time about how you applied for 5310, and we have changed again. So in this application cycle, you will be submitting one application for each funding opportunity that you're interested in. So if you want to apply for vehicles, operating, and other capital or mobility management, you will be submitting three separate applications. And I just want to note that because I know in Olga, these were all combined, and I know that was probably easier in many ways. But ultimately, the way that Web Grants works, everything really gets tied back to the funding opportunity, and we really have to have those separated out in this program. Okay, so I just wanted to note here, when you're looking at the funding opportunity, you can see some very basic information. You can see that it's a transit program, and you can see the due date here. So you can see I've set this to February 1st at 11:59 p.m. That will be the due date for this for these applications. So you'll have until about midnight on February 1st to get that in. And I'm going to go ahead and click into the capital vehicles application or funding opportunity. Sorry. So under the funding opportunity, remember, you're logged in as yourself and you're associated with your organization. So if I'm me at the Virginia Department of Rail and Public Transportation, what I see at the top of this funding opportunity is any applications that have been created under this funding opportunity. So you can see, again, I'm in this test environment. I've been in here and I've been creating applications. So this is kind of nice because when you go in, you'll immediately be able to see, okay, I've created, well, you'll probably, hopefully have only created one, but if you've created multiple, just to try to get your hands around this, you'll be able to see, okay, I've got this application, there's my title, and it's in editing mode. So anytime I want to go in to start editing my application, I'm going to click right here and just start going in there and editing. And we're going to get to that in a second. But first, I really want to show you when you scroll down, you'll see a little more detail about this funding opportunity. So this section just describes, again, some information about the funding opportunity itself. So again, this is the capital vehicles. It's due on February 1st. The project dates, so you know, the award period is October 1st through September 30th. The program officer is me. There's my work number and there's my email, so you can get in touch with me right from here. There's a brief description about the funding opportunity itself. And this section is actually, DRPT populates any information you need for the application here. So whenever you go back to this funding opportunity to look at your application, you'll be able to find, other materials that will help you apply. So this is some quarterly report guidance, and this is actually the template that you would fill out and submit with your application. So this will all be right here for you. And then there's just a link to DRPT website if you need more information from there. So this is really just the information about the funding opportunity, capital vehicles in this case. And you can see here, this is also where I can start a new application for my organization. So I'm just going to go ahead and click into this. And I'm just going to briefly, again, take you through how we're going to create an application here. So there's a wizard. It's going to kind of take you through, tell you what to do. You're going to want to create a title. I'm just going to say this is, RPT, capital vehicle. 25 application. Your title does not need to be creative or particularly descriptive. I would say you can just use your organization name, the type of funding opportunity you're applying for, and the year. Really very basic. You're going to tie a particular contact as the primary contact, and that will tie back, course, to their profile information. I'm going to keep it as the transportation tester because that's me. But if you had a different contact, you could put it in there. And then here's really the key thing is you're going to save this form information. And it's going to show you a screen again where if for some reason you want to change an organization or if you're associated with another organization, you would put that here. You're not going to really have to worry about this. It'll just be your organization that pops up. I'm going to save the form again. And then finally, if there's any additional contacts that I want to add to this particular application, I could just add them right here. And again, that's just pulling directly from where we went into my profile and looked at our organization. And those are the exact people who are in my organization, and I can just pop them right in there. So for now, again, that's not required. I'm just going to leave that off, and I'm going to save the form again. So when I get into the form or the application, rather, you're going to be able to see here all the different components of the application. And this should look somewhat familiar to the narrative that you've seen in the past in Olga. And when you go into one of these, you're just going to click on the section you want to go to. Real quick, just a note, it will tell you that, you know, right now you can't submit this application. There's no option up here to submit. There's an option to withdraw. You can preview it, but you can't submit it because these little checkboxes are going to have to be here in order for you to submit. And I'll show you how you get that done. So I'm going to go into my project information. And again, you can kind of see here, this just orients you. Okay, I'm in my application. This is for capital vehicles. And I'm going to go down. And this is where I start to fill out this project information. And you can see here, you know, the required fields are going to be in red. They're going to be starred. So you'll just go down, fill all this out. And I'm going to show you exactly what you need to do to get those checkboxes. So I'm just going to fill out test information because I have to put in something. And this is, again, should look very similar to what you've seen in Olga. I'm applying for replacement vehicles. I'm not planning on generating any revenue. My service schedule is going to be Monday through Friday. And I'm going to put some vehicles here just to fill this out real quick. Okay. So I filled out all this information. I'm going, all right, I want to get past the screen. I want to get to the next section. What I need to do is I need to save this form. And here you can see, once you save it, you'll see all that information pop up that you filled in. And you can just take a look at it and say, all right, that looks good. Or I want to edit it again. But when you feel like it's complete, and you can use this as kind of an internal system as well, to say this section is complete, you're going to mark it as complete. And then that's when that little checkbox pops up for you. So basically every single section here follows that same formula. We're going to be looking at the forms, filling it in, and then when you feel like it's complete, you can do that checkbox. Now, if I go back in here, I can still edit this form. You can continue to edit this form as much as you want, even if you've marked it as complete. That's just kind of a way for the system to know this section is ready. And when I go to submit, I need to make sure all those checkboxes are complete in order to submit. Okay. I want to make sure I get to everything on my list here. So I'm actually going to take you through one other step, but I'm going to leave off on this new application for now. And I'm just going to show you what it looks like to go back into an application that you have started. Okay, so I'm going to go back to my funding opportunities. I'm going to go to 5310 operating. And let's say that I'd already, you know, started a new application just like we did. I saved the form. And I want to go back in and edit. So again, when I go to that funding opportunity, I can see here all the applications that I've got in editing status. And I'm just going to click into that. And here I can see what's already been filled out. So this is kind of helpful. Again, if you got more than one person who's in there editing the application, you can click in and just see, okay, what have they filled out? and what's still missing. So it looks like, you know, I've still got a lot of information here and needs to be filled out. So I'm going to go ahead and click edit application. And this should look familiar. So you're going to start clicking back into your kind of tabs here. And maybe, you know, my boss told me to work on the implementation plan. So I'm going to go ahead and click in here and I'm going to start editing the form. So that is a really basic overview of what these applications are going to look like. I want to go ahead and pause and see if there's any questions that you all have. I know it's new and it's a lot. There's going to be more training about this, but I wanted to familiarize you with this program. So is there anything anyone would like me to cover again based on what I, oh, I just saw Tony, I'm sorry. Okay, it looks like you got it, okay. All right. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and move on for now. If you have questions come up as we go along, oh, here we go. Number of vehicles is the total number of current vehicles or the number being requested. So that will be, what I showed you was your current vehicle inventory, and then there will be another tab that says requested vehicles, and you'll be able to enter in those in another tab. So it will be, should be pretty obvious. Here, let me show you real quick. Let me just show you that real quick. Michael. Under capital vehicles, so what I was under was general information, but you're going to have this section that says requested vehicles, and that's where you're actually going to put in your requested vehicles right here, and this is actually going to do math for you based on our estimates, and I will get to this these estimates a little later in the presentation, but you're going to do that. And it's actually going to add up those vehicle numbers for you, and we'll be able to see how many are being requested. So yeah, hopefully it should be fairly straightforward once you kind of are able to get in there and see what, you know, what the tabs look like. But that's a good question. All right, I'm going to go ahead and move on for now, but I hope that was sort of helpful. Jennifer, I'll get to that question a little later. Thank you. And let me just bring back up my presentation real quick here. All right. Okay, so I, for those of you who have to follow along on the bottom, I'm now on slide 13. Now I'm on slide 14. We went over any questions. Actually, Jennifer, I'll go ahead and answer you. There are not any significantly different questions. There are some that are formatted slightly differently. So there's some areas where, for example, I pulled out something like where you, if we're asking to list a number of things, it's just a box where it says, you know, put the number of X here and you fill that in versus it being inside the narrative, just to kind of make that clear. But you shouldn't be seeing anything significantly different. But again, I will be providing you with those questions as part of the slides that come out from this presentation. So you'll actually get those and be able to start looking through that and seeing what questions you have. All right, I'm moving on to slide 15. And we're gonna go ahead and go into the general application guidance. So moving on to slide 16. I want to share this timeline. I think it's just helpful to get an idea of how the application cycle works overall. So again, December 1st, applications are gonna open in web grants. For those of you who have vehicles, currently have 5310 vehicles, you will need to update your Trans Am data by January 15th as part of your application and as part of your requirements, but definitely if you're applying, make sure you get that updated. And I'll talk about that a little more later. February 1st is when the applications are due. And then we kind of go into our review process. So, and this is sort of a general time frame. As many of you know, this can change slightly depending on how it goes. But in general, DRPT, we are reviewing applications from February through March. And then we make our recommendations and we present that to the Commonwealth Transportation Board. And it, generally at that time, we notify you whether you're being recommended for funding. At that time, there's also public hearings, and we send you out generally a survey that kind of indicates that you're going to commit to accepting an award, providing local match. So we kind of start getting that set up. And then we get the final presentation to the CTB, Commonwealth Transportation Board. And you'll get an official notification, which is the SIT publication. I know some of you require award letters. That's usually something that if you ask for that, I will definitely provide it to you. So this, usually we send out a notification from our DRPT blast and you'll get that, but that should become, that always basically comes out in June. So June is really when you'll know for sure that you're getting an award. And that's kind of where we finalize that. Going on from there, we start developing award contracts. For any of those who are getting vehicles, you will complete your order sheets with our vendor. So specifying, what you want in your vehicle. And then October 1st is when the grant project period begins. Moving on to slide 17. So there are three types of funding under the 5310 program. That's capital, vehicle, operating, other capital, mobility management, and operating. I'm going to talk about each of these in a little more detail later, but just as an overview, capital vehicle are replacement or expansion vehicles for transportation to the eligible population. Obviously, replacement vehicles are replacement of any 5310 vehicles. For this one, for this grant, the FTA requires a 20% local match. Other capital is defined as mobility management projects, which include one call, one click centers, travel training, and trip coordination among agencies. The capital cost of contracting for transportation and other capital purchases, such as software. These require this is a 4% local match for agencies. We say generally, just because Virginia provides 16% of that, it technically can change, but it hasn't changed in a very long time. So I would plan on a 4% local match for that. And then operating, that is direct transportation expenses for an approved project. And again, of the 50% local match, Virginia provides 40%. Generally, but again, has not changed in a long time. And so a minimum of a 10% local match is required from the agencies for that. And just a note here that in-kind expenses are not eligible for a local match. Slide 18. This is kind of what I went over with the web grants, but just to reemphasize the application and its components. So you will submit one application per funding opportunity. As in a separate application must be submitted under each funding opportunity. I kind of spell it out an example there, but another thing to note there is, for example, if you're applying to both operating and other capital or mobility mobility management grants, you will need to fill out and submit two separate line item budgets as attachments. So again, these are totally separate. They have their own separate attachments, narratives, everything. That being said, like if you're filling out our quarterly report, if you remember what those look like, it has the tabs along the bottom, which with each of these application area project areas indicated. So you can be submitting the same quarterly report for each of those applications. We'll just look and see, you filled out the correct work plan under each one. And finally, I want to say that I know it's cumbersome to be having to submit the same application for the same project over and over again. You can, of course, I hope it's obvious, but you can submit the exact same answers in the narrative if it's for the same project. Unfortunately, you cannot copy over applications from one funding opportunity to another. Again, this is kind of the web grant system. It keeps the funding opportunities very siloed into their own lane. So everything that you're doing within that funding opportunity kind of has to stay in there. But the narrative questions are going to be largely the same. So if you're doing operating and mobility management, just copy and paste those answers over to the other one. There shouldn't be any surprises in the narrative for that. The only thing that's a little different is vehicles, but that's just because you're filling in those requested vehicles. In terms of the components of the application, again, we kind of saw this in web grants, but just to list it here, you've got your organizational profile that's going to be attached to your application. Just a note here, if you have a current organization in Olga, this will be imported over to web grants. So hopefully, in theory, you're not going to have to refill out your organizational information. But again, it's just kind of that basic information that will kind of be there for you in web grants on December 1st. A narrative portion is part of the application. And then attachments are another important part of the application. And these include line item budgets for operating and other capital grants, and then a quarterly report, which is now required for all applications. And we'll talk about that more. Going on to slide 19. So as I mentioned, DRPT awards funds through a competitive discretionary program. So we have funding priorities. This does not mean if you do not meet one of these priorities that you won't be funded. This is just to give you more information about what DRPT is looking for, especially because, as you know, we have a requirement from the FDA to fulfill at least 55% capital funding, at least. So we have to fulfill that. That's kind of what we prioritize as number one. So the first one is to continue providing support to existing 5310 programs, prioritizing capital to meet that minimum funding requirement per funding area. Two is to increase publicly available services to the 5310 population. So this could include any of the eligible project types, but what we're saying with publicly is that it cannot be offered on a client or customer only basis. So again, it's just a priority, not saying we're not fulfilling client or customer only projects, but we're going to prioritize publicly available transportation. Three is to expand the availability of existing client-based transportation programs, including providing expansion vehicles to existing client-based services. So again, that's kind of on the bottom of our list of priorities, but it's just to give you an idea of what we're looking at when we're going through your applications. So existing programs are only considered continued if, of course, they remain eligible and there's a continued demand for service, continued need for government subsidy, and a commitment of local support. So those are all things you're going to address in your application as part of our application questions. So that's, again, what we're reading through your narrative. If you've applied year after year, we're still looking for making sure, you're still eligible, you still have a demand for your service, and you still have a need for DRPT support. But we also definitely want to see that you have local support committed and you're continuing to look for other sources of funding to make sure that you're not solely relying on DRPT for your operations. Okay, I'm going to go ahead, move on to slide 20. So I wanted to touch on the attachments for all project types as well as for specific projects. So this kind of goes through, I just wanted to kind of touch on a few specific ones because I know sometimes questions come up about these. First of all, I wanted to note two new required attachments are your most recent organization budget and your transportation program budget. These you'll see in web grants that they won't be required for you to submit an application, but I am, as in the platform will not prevent you from applying if you don't have those attached, but that is something that we definitely want to see. I know sometimes people don't have necessarily a specific transportation budget, but we'd at least like to see, you know, kind of how that's breaking out in your overall organization. Another thing to note here is the copy of public notice in an area newspaper. You're required to place a public notice, not an advertisement, that specifically states what you'll be applying for. So the purpose of putting an actual public notice is that so someone looking for this information can find it in a designated section of the newspaper rather than having to search through the newspaper to find an ad. So this is the public notice typically goes to in the legal section of the newspaper. We just like to specify this because this is just something we look for and counts towards points on your application. And there's in the guidance document, there's a template of what that looks like, and you can just follow that and put in your organization's name in your project. The next thing I wanted to note is the required letter of notice to area MPO. This is only for small and large urbanized areas. So those are areas that would have an MPO. That letter to the MPO is actually going to be due by December 31st. And I'll make sure to write this in here when I send these slides out. There used to not be a time limit on this, but MPOs were finding that, you know, they were getting these in kind of last minute. And they just need a little more turnaround time to be able to get that in. So, you know, you'll want to submit that letter to your MPOs by the end of December. And again, in the guidance, I have examples of what that letter will look like that you can follow along with. And let's see. Finally, the current fiscal year quarterly report. So again, I'm going to get into performance metrics a little bit more, but everyone applying is required to submit a quarterly report, and including capital vehicles. So I know that wasn't the case in the past, but that's what we're going to be doing moving forward. I'm just looking, sorry, at the chat. What is a SAM debarment check? So Nita, I can get with you after the presentation to go over this, but SAM.gov is a website through which basically, since we're dealing with federal funding, the federal government requires that you have an active SAM account, and it's something that they have to check through in order to give out federal funding. It's sort of basic, but essentially you have to provide proof that you are up to date in SAM.gov. I would recommend that you go ahead and go to SAM.gov, and if your organization isn't already registered in there, you're going to want to, you know, make sure you start that process early on. So thanks for asking that. All right, next slide, slide 21. These are project type specific attachments. And when you go into the web grants application, you'll see, like if you're in the capital vehicle application, you'll see these listed there for you. You don't have to guess, it'll all be spelled out. But for these, for operating and other capital, you will be providing a line item project budget, as well as if you are doing other capital, like a software purchase or procurement, you'll want to give an independent cost estimate there. Again, that will be an optional one, only if you're doing that with your project. Under capital vehicle, you're going to want to submit a DMV sales tax exemption if applicable. I'm actually going to talk about that in more detail in a little while. A copy of your vehicle insurance package and your preventative maintenance plan and schedule. Moving on to slide number 22. So this should be fairly familiar to anyone who's applied, but an important part of the process after you apply is to sign the FTA certifications and insurances. This is just something that, again, is given to us by the FTA to make sure that everyone sort of is complying with their guidelines and policies. We'll also have a state master agreement and project agreements. This is all sort of as some of you know, it's kind of after your application is submitted or once you have a project. But really the thing to note, the thing I want to note here is no matter what, whether you're signing the certs and assurances, the state master agreement or the project agreements, these must be signed by someone authorized to sign on behalf of the sub-recipient organization. So when it comes to web grants, this is going to be someone that you all have to indicate to us who that will be. And so in the past, we had the master user. Now we just have users under your organization. But you all are going to be the ones who need to determine, you know, if it's your executive director, they need to have an accountant there. And then you have to indicate to us whether we're assigning it to that person to sign. So this is a little bit of a change of process, but hopefully again, I know in the past with the master user it had been a little bit not ideal if someone was the master user who didn't have the authority to sign. So hopefully this will actually kind of make that process a little bit smoother. And just a note here that aside from project specific information, most language in the agreements and of course in the certs and assurances cannot be changed. So this is just a note when you're looking through those agreements that if you're looking for a change, it's really important to understand that these documents go through an extensive internal review process and are reviewed and approved by the Office of the Attorney General. So there really isn't much wiggle room to change those. All right, I'm going to pause here for any other questions. I think I answered everything in the chat, but if you have a question, you can raise your hand. Okay, seeing none so far, I'm going to go ahead and move on to performance reporting. So this section, I know I have had a lot of questions about performance reporting. I gave a presentation to the FY24 awardees in September about this. Jane, can you review the different authorities, contracts versus certs and assurances? Jane, I might have to get back to you on that one. I'll come back to you on that. We might have to talk about that at a different time. Thanks. So for performance reporting, I just want to note that I know I presented about this in September, but some things have changed because of web grants, and I'm going to go through it now. And I want you all to just try to hang with me because I want this to be something that is clear for you all. So the first thing to note is that monthly ridership reporting is not going to be required any longer. So with this new system launch, basically, in the past, it was required sort of as a requirement. Tony, great. I'm glad you're happy about it. It was kind of required as a component of OLGA, the way that system worked. But the more we've learned about web grants, the more we've realized that that is really just not something that is required for this whole system to work for 5310. So it's going away. So I know many folks who have only been doing capital vehicles, that's what they've been familiar with. They haven't dealt with anything else. So I want to now bring you into the world of quarterly reporting. So instead of monthly reporting, we are only going to be doing quarterly reports. It's now required for all applicants, including vehicle only, to submit a quarterly report, which the quarterly report will include ridership. So now you are not reporting ridership in two different places. It's only in your quarterly report. And that's how you'll be submitting it to us. So as you kind of saw in web grants, that template is going to be in there for you for when you start working on your application. We're going to look at it briefly. Again, it'll be sent to you with this. I've gone over extensively in the past, but I know for anyone new, we might need a little more training on that, and that's fine. I can provide all the information you need about it, but I'm going to touch on it somewhat briefly for this presentation, just so we can get through everything today. The way this is going to work is that when you submit an application, you will fill out your projected metrics or in appropriate work plans and submit that as an attachment with your application. So the work plan is reflected. So each work plan reflects the project area you're applying under. So in the quarterly report, there are going to be, it's a spreadsheet, there's tabs along the bottom. It says capital vehicle, operating, and other capital. And that's where you'll go to find your metrics, as well as all projects, which I'll get to in a second. Okay, so I just touched on this, but just wanted to note again, we're not doing monthly ridership reporting. Ridership will still be tracked in your quarterly report. This is how we define it. And you will still need to go ahead and make sure you're keeping up to date with your trip logs so that that's not something where, again, we're not requiring that you submit your trip logs along with the report. That's not a requirement, but, you know, sometimes circumstances arise where we might have to ask you for a trip log. So you're just going to make sure that you're keeping track of that on the back end and that's available in case we need to back something up. Sorry, moving on to slide 27. So the quarterly report is required for all grantees for all project types. It has pre-selected metrics provided to you in a spreadsheet. For the application, you will fill out your projections and submit that template document as an attachment. In the spreadsheet, as I mentioned, there are four work plans. Those are tabs along the bottom. There's an all projects tab, capital vehicle tab, operating tab, and other capital tab. So all applicants will complete the all projects tab. The capital vehicle tab is new and all vehicle applicants must submit this one. And then, you know, if you're applying for operating, you'll fill that out. If you're applying for other capital, you'll fill that out as well. So if, you know, your project is accepted and we move forward with executing your agreement, you will use the same spreadsheet to submit your performance metrics to me quarterly via either email or with your claim and web grants. Claim is the new word we are using for reimbursement request. But obviously, if you have a vehicle only, then you will just be submitting that to me via email. This could change in the future as we sort of explore different functions that Web Grants has. But for the time being, just know that you can submit it to me via email until we, you know, let you know anything differently. Going on to slide 28, this is something I showed in September. This is what the old quarterly report spreadsheet looks like. Going on to slide 29, this is what the new quarterly report spreadsheet looks like. And just again, want to point out here along the bottom, you can see these little tabs that show the work plans and all the metrics are spelled out here for you to fill out. Sorry, going on to slide, 30. As I mentioned, you'll use the exact same spreadsheet if you're awarded as the one that you fill out as part of your application. We know things will probably change between February 1st and October 1st. That's okay. You know, what you projected may not be exactly what happens. The point is, it's a projection. We know that things change and there'll be opportunities for you to provide additional explanation if something major happens in your organization that affects your performance metrics. I just kind of wanted to spell this out for you all, how to fill out this quarterly report. Tab one is your agency profile. I'm just going to click back to slide 29 real quick. You can see here this tab that says agency profile. When you click into that, you'll just see a place to put in your organization information and your goals for each program area. You want to fill out at least this information just so that it's on that spreadsheet in case for some reason, you know, in my emails, your spreadsheet isn't labeled or gets saved somewhere. That's just so we can kind of, you know, keep track of you, make sure I know exactly whose spreadsheet I'm looking at. And you'll want to fill out some goals. There's some additional information in that tab that you can use, like putting in numbers for your budget, but that's really just all optional. It's kind of for you if you want to use it. So I just want to spell this out really clearly, exactly how to fill out this quarterly report if you're applying. If you're applying for operating funding, you will fill out tabs 2 and 3, the All Projects Work Plan and the Operating Work Plan. If you're applying for other capital mobility management, you'll fill out tabs 2 and 4, All Projects Work Plan and Other Capital Work Plan. If you're applying for capital vehicles, you'll fill out tabs 2 and 5, All Projects Work Plan and Capital Vehicles Work Plan. If you're applying for any combination of these three, the message here is please fill out the All Projects Work Plan and whatever additional work plan you are using as part of your application. Additionally, there is a guidance document that's provided to you as part of this presentation, as well as that is going to be available to you in WebGrants under that funding opportunity. Please use that guidance to determine how to measure your metrics. It provides instructions and kind of definitions of what we're looking for, and to determine which are required or optional for your project or organization. So again, I know some of you may not be as familiar with the quarterly report as others. If you have questions about this, I really encourage you, take a look at the spreadsheet, take a look at the guidance after this presentation, and just start thinking about what you'll need to submit. It should not be significantly different than what you've been submitting in the past, but I know a lot of folks have had questions and wanted to check in on things, and that's totally fine. You're welcome to send me questions. All right. I'm just going to pause here. Again, if you have a question right now, feel free to raise your hand or put something in the chat. I'll just give it a minute as I drink a little sip of water. Sarah, will we need to do quarterly reports for vehicles awarded in past years? So basically you'll be reporting on your 5310 fleet. So essentially, yes, you'll be reporting on your 5310 vehicles only. So they will be included in those ridership numbers, just like they were in the monthly reports, but they'll be in the quarterly report now. All right, I'm going to go ahead and move on to slide 32. Oh, sorry, Tony. For FY24, Will we be using the new templates or the templates we submitted? For FY24, it should all be translated into this template. So I know it might be a little bit different than what you submitted if you were using the old one for FY24, but FY24 was really the first year that this one was supposed to be used. If you need help with that, Tony, or if you want me to review it, that's totally fine. But yeah, you should be using this template. But it might be the exact same numbers that you put in originally. Okay, cool. Thanks. Okay, cool. All right, so moving on, I'm going to get into the each specific project type. So right now we're going to look specifically at the vehicle portion of this program. So those of you who are only applying for operating or mobility management, feel free to get up, take a stretch, have a drink of water. I'm going to be getting into this. So just as an overview, DRPT does not award funds for a grantee to purchase their own vehicles. DRPT purchases new accessible vehicles, which we'll go over a little bit more in the next slide. So you can be awarded for replacement or expansion vehicles. Replacement is defined as replacement of 5310 vehicles that have reached their useful life. The useful life is defined as 4 years and 100,000 miles. If you don't meet these two criteria, we may consider earlier replacements. This could be due to issues such as like ongoing documented issues where something's not being resolved. If it's a lemon, if you're just having issues over and over again, we would consider it. We've also been using 10 years as kind of a mark as something that, again, you want to reach out and make sure it's eligible. But if your vehicle is 10 years old or older, but still hasn't reached that 100,000 miles, you might consider that as an exception. This is just sort of, there are exceptions to the rule, but want you to keep in mind 4 years and 100,000 miles if you're applying for replacement vehicles. Also want to clarify, this is a minimum required useful life. You may choose to operate your vehicles for additional years and miles. You do not have to hold yourself to these minimum criteria. So it's not required that you replace these vehicles at their useful life. It's up to you to determine which vehicles you want to replace, what's working for you, what you need, that sort of thing in that arena. The capital vehicle project type requires a 20% local match. So that's an 80% federal share, 20% local match. The local match must be documented in the application and will be collected before vehicles are ordered. Just want to emphasize here that, again, these are federal dollars we're dealing with. There is actually no state money attached to this. So when we kind of hold to these kind of stiff ideas around how we can purchase the vehicles, what the requirements are for maintaining them, all these different things, just keep in mind that when we're purchasing these vehicles, we're stewarding federal money and we only have so many options at DRPT for how that can be managed. Another note here about requesting replacement vehicles that I forgot to mention. So when you're requesting a vehicle replacement, you need to ensure that the vehicle you are replacing is recorded in Trans Am. So in the application and web grants, you will be asked to list the VIN, year, date put into service, make, model, and mileage of any vehicles you're requesting to be replaced. And you need to make sure this information matches what's in Trans Am and make sure you are giving us the VIN number and not something like the asset ID. So we really emphasize using the VIN numbers because it is that unique identifier that keeps us all on the same page. So I just wanted to note that, make sure you're getting to Trans Am, keeping everything updated, make sure it matches your application so we can ensure that those vehicles you're requesting to be replaced are eligible and that those vehicles are the ones that you are agreeing to essentially take out of service to be replaced. A little more information about that. So if you submit an application asking for a replacement vehicle, please be sure that you will be removing that vehicle from service. To remove a vehicle from service, that means you're either going to dispose of the vehicle or use it as backup only. So if you are still going to be regularly using the vehicle, do not request a replacement for it. You should be requesting an expansion. So I know this can be a little bit confusing, and there's, an idea that you have to request a replacement in order to get an award, which is not true. That's something that is something we prioritize, but it really needs to be what you're actually going to be using the vehicle for. So if you do have questions about whether you should request a replacement or expansion, or you just kind of want to talk through, what your fleet is looking like, what you're thinking about, please reach out to me and, schedule a call and we can talk about that. And just another reminder, again, straight from the FTA, all vehicles are to be used for the sole purpose of transporting seniors and individuals with disabilities. If you get any questions about this, please talk to me as well. Going on to slide 34. some application requirements for specific to capital vehicle awards. So, and some of this I mentioned before, but Trans Am needs to be up to date by January 15th. This updating process does count toward points on your application. Your monthly ridership, I'm sorry. I did not update this slide, I apologize. Your quarterly report, if you had one, needs to be submitted with your application. If you had a past quarterly report, that needs to be up to date. But otherwise, just make sure you have that with your application. Just sort of ignore this. Your preventative maintenance plan, if you're applying for vehicles, that needs to be attached to the application as well. You need to make sure you have operator training that's established, or you know, is planned to be established, and that you've described that in the narrative. And again, that Title VI and ADA need to be in place, or you need to have a plan to put it in place, and that will be a required attachment as well. I just kind of wanted to spell out, as you're thinking about applying, what you need to be thinking about if you're applying for vehicles, what we're going to be asking about or asking for in the application. Moving on to slide 34 or 35. So the preventative maintenance requirement. So every applicant needs to have a preventative maintenance plan in place if you're applying for vehicles for directly operated transportation. This includes policies and procedures for maintenance, a maintenance schedule with distinct oil change intervals indicated, and a pre and trip inspection log needs to be part of your plan. So that oil change note there, the plan must identify a single mileage interval for oil changes, such as every 5,000 miles. This is something, again, that we and the FTA look at when checking for compliance, just to make sure that you are maintaining these vehicles appropriately. And when we are looking at compliance, we're making sure you're compliant with that interval at least 80% of the time. So again, there's a little wiggle room there, but just so you're keeping in your mind, that needs to be something you're submitting with your application. And this plan is due as an attachment with the application. Slide number 36. There's a lot of information on this slide, I apologize, but I just wanted to provide this information for the vehicles that are available. As I mentioned before, DRPT will not award funds for your agency to purchase vehicles. We purchase vehicles on your agency's behalf. If you're awarded a vehicle, you will work with our vendor to specify your order, and then they will send us the order sheets with all of your specifications. So from there, we'll ask for your local match, develop a project agreement, and then execute the purchase. So that's kind of, once you're, if you're awarded, that's how that process works. But so we have a vehicle menu that you'll apply for which types of vehicles you would like. For this program, we have modified 5-passenger minivans with ramps, and then 9-passenger raised roof vans or high tops. And then we have 14, 15, and 19-passenger BOCs, or body on chassis, with lifts. And all of these vehicles can be further modified to accommodate more wheelchairs, and or you can do different seat arrangements and all that. So those are the types of things that you can work with our vendor. So this is something that, you know, those of you who have applied for vehicles year after year, you're familiar with, and you're probably familiar with the price increases for vehicles. I've listed the award amounts here that are estimates for this year's applications. So generally we provide estimates as the award, because since we're not starting to start the vehicle order process until October, we have to provide an estimate because sometimes the prices do go up. So the estimates listed here, and generally what we do is like 10 to 15% over the what we anticipate to be the actual cost. When your final contract is executed, As in when we go through the whole application process, you've ordered the vehicle, you've put in the specifications, that final contract will reflect the actual vehicle amount, and the local match owed will be based on the actual vehicle amount we order, not on the estimate. So that award amount is fixed, and any modifications over the award amount will come out of pocket, but you can put on modifications up to that award amount. And then from that, we'll determine what the local match amount is. So I know there's a lot of information there. Let me know if you have any questions about that. Again, I know a lot of you are familiar with this process, but just wanted to share this. And again, these amounts are what are reflected in the current application that you kind of briefly saw in Web Grants, and it will kind of calculate those amounts for you based on how many vehicles you put in. All right, we let's go to slide number 37. For capital vehicles, the sales tax versus DMV sales tax exemption. So I wanted to create this slide because there's been some confusion about this on our side as well as grantee's side. So just want to point out specifically that the IRS sales tax, being IRS sales tax exempt, is not the same as being sales tax exempt from the DMV. The DMV sales tax exemption requires its own paperwork. That's something that your organization would do on its own. It's not something that DRPT is involved in. So 501c3 nonprofits and other IRS sales tax exempt organizations submit a letter proving their IRS sales tax exemptions in your attachments. That's one of the required attachments. But if you are DMV sales tax exempt, that is actually a separate proof of exemption, and that is listed as an attachment under the capital vehicle. So if you do not submit that proof, the DMV sales tax will be added to your final vehicle order, and you will be paying 20% local match on that tax amount. So just want to point this out. And I think, you know, last year, the last 3 years have been a little bit confusing. Things have gotten a little confusing with that just because we had to submit a very large order. But just going forward, I just want to be clear that the sales tax for DMV is separate from IRS and requires a separate proof that will be that will affect your final vehicle order. Going to slide 38. Again, this is kind of just talking about Trans Am. Ensure that your agency has a Trans Am account and that the manager role is filled by a current employee. When you're applying, again, you'll need to be going in and updating your Trans Am account. So you want to make sure that you have someone in there who is current and you can get in touch with. Trans Am should only be used to manage vehicles awarded through DRPT. So ensure your vehicles in there are current. And if you know, if there's vehicles in there that you don't own anymore or you disposed of, make sure you mark that. If there's vehicles in there that are not 5310, we're going to need to delete those essentially, or indicate what they are so we're not referencing those. And then the Trans Am updates are due twice per year, January 15th and July 15th. And the most important thing you'll need to update especially for your application, is the mileage. So you'll want to go through and update all the mileage, but especially those ones that you're looking to replace, and then go through and indicate your service status and condition. Those are kind of the most important things we look for, particularly with the application. Again, if you have questions about Trans Am, we can talk about that outside of this particular presentation, but I'm going to go ahead and on slide 39, look at the chat here. So Jen asked, in the past, 5310 vehicles could be used for incidental use of transporting goods. Has this changed with the sole purpose statement? So Jen, this the incidental use is really kind of meant to be like a one-time or occasional thing that you reach out to DRPT about and let us know sort of like what you're doing with the vehicles. it's not meant to be an ongoing thing. So there are cases for incidental use to transport different things with the vehicles. It's just more of keeping communication with us about what's going on and making sure that's not a regular part of your programming. Does anyone else have any questions about capital vehicles specifically? All right, I'm gonna go ahead and move along to the other capital section. If you have questions, you can continue dropping in the chat. So we're gonna look at other capital, which includes mobility management, travel training, capital cost of contracting, and other services or products. So just to go through an overview, other capital includes mobility management, which is defined as a program that is intended to improve coordination between existing public and human service transportation providers. This does not include the cost of trips or providing transportation. A person who works with one vendor or agency to set up rides is not a mobility manager. Mobility management is true coordination among and across agency types. If you have questions about this, let me know. I know most mobility managers who have been applying kind of know what the deal is, but you know, if you're new to this, if you're not sure exactly how that's defined, please let me know. And if you do end up submitting an application for mobility management that should be operating, then DRPT will consider it to be an operating request. So we will kind of look at that and let you know if that's not correct. But sorry, Clark, can vehicle only applicants leave now? Clark, I would say you are good to go. Yes, vehicle only applicants, if you would like to head out, if you don't have any more questions, you can go ahead and leave. I don't want to keep you here because I know this is a long presentation. All right, sorry, getting back to mobility management. Yeah, just want to emphasize it's among agencies. Mobility management also includes trip planning and coordination, one call, one click systems, and travel training. Another category under other capital includes capital cost of contracting. So this is using a federally compliant procurement process to contract with a transportation provider such as a turnkey service. This is something I want to emphasize and I will talk about a little bit more later too. Capital cost of contracting. If you are contracting with a service provider, that needs to be its own application under other capital. This is not an operating expense, and it's going to have a separate line item budget that is capital cost of contracting. Another category under other capital includes something I call other capital, which is just essentially like procurement of software or other technology. This is something that we don't fund very often, but it is eligible. So if you have any questions about that, or if you have an idea about some kind of technology your organization is interested in purchasing through this, please do reach out to me about that, just because it requires a little bit more procurement and things that your agency needs to have in place. Again, the match amounts for this category are an 80% federal match, 16% Virginia match, and a 4% local match. And I'm going to move on to slide 42. Just to get into a little more detail about mobility management and what is eligible under mobility management, this is people and associated costs, not trips. Eligible expenses include up to 2 staff salaries and benefits. We do ask for you to include some job descriptions for those as part of the application. But when we say to staff salaries and benefits, the only thing that's exempt from this, as in can apply for more, are local and regional one-call, one-click systems. So that's kind of like a unique category. We really only have a couple of those in the state. But if you have questions about that, let me know. Marketing or advertisement costs up to $10,000 or 10% of the project cost, less equipment, whichever is less. That does not include bus wraps or on-vehicle signage. Those are actually considered supply costs rather than marketing, I believe, because those are can be quite expensive. So we actually want to separate those out to give you a little more flexibility with your marketing dollars. It includes limited supportive supplies and equipment. Equipment is defined as an item that has a useful life of a year or more. So that's something you can think about, like a tablet, you know, a true kind of like equipment that is not just like an expendable supply. So that's sort of how you can think about that when you're looking at that budget, and I'll go over that a little bit more. And then indirect costs up to 10% of the modified total direct costs. And I know a lot of folks have questions about indirect costs. It's sort of a catch-all for what we think of as overall administrative costs that cannot be assigned to one specific project. So you're thinking about things like rent, expenses associated with your office space. It could be utilities associated with your office space. This also includes executive administrative, clerical, office maintenance and cleaning staff salaries, benefits, associated costs. So these are all things where, you know, the expense cannot be tied to just one project, such as the project you're applying for. It's really just costs that kind of keep your business up and running. So modified total, indirect costs, you do not, when you're, if you're awarded and you're applying for reimbursement, that's something you don't have to provide proof of. You're just saying, I need 10% to make sure we can keep the lights on and keep this project running. So I just wanted to kind of give some clarification on what indirect costs are. Under ineligible expenses, this list is in the guidance. This is a non-exhaustive list of eligible expenses. Just kind of wanted to note a few things here. Passes or vouchers for existing public transit or paratransit are ineligible. Another one I see sometimes is clothing. All clothing, including like promotional t-shirts or things like that for volunteers, that is ineligible. Employee mileage is ineligible. DMV registration is ineligible. And this one I want to note, expenses related to any DRPT application or grant management process. So those public notices, for example, you cannot ask for reimbursement for those. That's just something you have to pay for as part of the application process. Fundraising expenses are ineligible. So just make sure if, as you're filling out your budget, you kind of get an idea of what is ineligible. And those, again, are all listed in the guidance. Another thing I wanted to note is training expenses. I don't have a specific slide in here about RTAP, but we do have some training funds available through a separate grant program called RTAP. And you can submit requests through, if you become a grantee with us, RTAP may be available to you. So if you have more questions about that as you're getting into this process, we can chat about that. Does anyone have questions for now about the other capital? And I'm going to kind of go ahead and keep moving along because I want to make sure I get to everything. I'm just kind of looking at my time. So again, keep dropping questions in the chat if you have them come up. But I'm going to move on to slide 45. We're going to talk about operating now. And this is going to look somewhat similar to the last slides, but with a few important differences. Slide 46, an overview of operating. So operating is kind of a broad category, but it's basically the delivery of service beyond existing public and human transportation options. So this could include expanded paratransit, more hours, providing same day or door-to-door service that comes with higher costs, It could also be travel training, and this could include vouchers for various non-public transit options and other transportation expenses for services that are publicly available to seniors and individuals with disabilities. So again, it's kind of broad, includes a lot of different things. If you have questions about what's included in there, we can chat about that. Or if you're not sure if you're under mobility management or operating, reach out and let me know. But the match amounts, 50% federal match, 40% Virginia match, and a 10% local match. So your local match on that is a bit higher. And that's just something that you want to think about as you're putting together your budget. Moving on to slide 47, eligible expenses are, the basic expense eligibility is net operating expenses, meaning the cost to operate minus any fares collected. So there's a wide variety of eligible expenses, and I'm just highlighting a few here. This includes driver salaries and benefits, vehicle expenses like fuel, insurance and maintenance. And then I just repeated exactly what was in the other capital category. So marking an advertisement up to 10,000 or 10% of the project cost less equipment, whichever is less. Limited supportive supplies and equipment. And then indirect costs up to 10%. So again, this is kind of repeated, but important to note here, we're kind of talking about direct expenses related to the administration of your, or the execution of your program. I shouldn't say administration, because if you do have administrative costs like your executive staff or staff who are not doing things that are specific to this project that you're asking for funding, those would be included under indirect costs. So if you are asking for other kind of management salaries, you're going to want to separate that out, like by a percentage, or we need to see some indication that it's very specific to just the transportation program and not kind of the overall administration of the organization. Moving on to slide 48, this is the exact same slide. I already went over this, but this also applies to operating. All right, instead of getting into questions right now, I actually want to look at some budget template examples. I wanted to go over this because when we're looking at applications, it's something that I want to specify, because I think it will make all of our lives a bit easier if you know exactly what I'm looking for and what we're looking for when we're processing applications and looking at your budgets. So like I said before, if you're applying for operating and mobility management, for example, those are going to be two separate line item budgets. And I want to go ahead and pull up an example I created of some different ones here. So I'm going to first pull up an example of an operating budget. And hopefully y'all can see this okay. But there we go. All right. So again, this is just an example, but I wanted to lay out how we would like to see this information. So if, as part of your operating budget, you're asking for driver salaries, we do not want to see drivers lumped together. I want to see them separated out. It kind of is up to you if you want to indicate their names. It doesn't even have to be specific people that are named. You can just say driver one, driver two, driver three, driver four. But we want to see them separated out, and you can give an indication of if they're full-time or if, they do a certain number of hours per week. However you want to kind of just show how you got to that calculation. And then the important thing I want to point out here is kind of how to use this spreadsheet. So you're going to put your line item here, and you're going to want to match the amount you're asking for under these columns. So I really want to see the correct, line item matching under the column, because these columns do align with specific calculations that go into your total. So I just want to point this out because these are set up this way for a reason, and they do do specific calculations, especially if you're asking for indirect costs. So I want to see each position separated out, and I want to see fringe benefits, if you're asking for those, separated out from salary and put under this correct category. So make sure you're separating these out so we can see exactly what you're asking for under each one. And then, for example, if you got marketing, you don't have to be more specific than marketing, but make sure you're putting marketing under the marketing column. If you're asking for example, a tablet for the vehicle, as I said, equipment is defined as something with a useful life of a year or more. I would consider a tablet something with a useful life of a year or more. You could ask for a tablet if you're using it only in your 5310 vehicle and only for 5310 purposes. So if I was asking for that, I would put that under the equipment category. So that would add up along the bottom there for me. If I'm asking for a bus wrap, as I mentioned, bus wrap or on vehicle signage is considered separate from marketing. So I'm going to put that under materials and supplies, as that's considered a separate cost. And that's exactly where you can put that. And then finally, if I want to ask for something other than something you might consider supply or equipment or marketing, like a DMV background check payment or cost, that is where I'd stick that under that other category and kind of, put a little bit more description in my line item. If you do have questions as you're going along with your budget, I encourage you to refer back to this presentation or the guidance. But if you've got questions, I can take a look at your budgets for you. It's not something that I would say I can offer to everyone. But if you have a really specific question about where something should fall, do reach out and, I'll try to give you some feedback on that. So then if you are asking for indirect costs, you would put that right here. So 10% is the de minimis. If you want to ask for indirect costs, which is eligible for operating or mobility management, you just want to put that right there unless you have a negotiated indirect costs, which you should know if your organization has a negotiated indirect costs. Most likely, if you haven't asked for a different indirect cost in the past, that's not something you have available to you. But 10% is considered the de minimis. That is something we'll accept without any proof that that's what you need. And then it will add up your total ask at the bottom. And that total is something you will enter into Web Grants as part of your application. So there'll just be literally a line in the form where it says project, amount, ask, and you'll put in that number once you have that all calculated. Also wanted to point out that fuel, maintenance, and insurance are listed here at the bottom. Please use these specific tabs as well, or lines as well, to fill those out and put them under the fuel, maintenance, and insurance column. This is just gonna make our lives a lot easier as we're processing all these applications. I wanted to go ahead and also share the I have another example here of what I was mentioning before. I've seen a lot of in applications, people submitting operating budgets that have cost of contracted transportation included as a line item in an operating budget, but this now really needs to be its own separate attachment that's included as your other capital mobility management application. So this is just an example of what that would look like. And a lot of you are familiar with this because this is how you submit it, and this is perfectly fine. You can just put contracted transportation, and you'll just put that amount other under that other category. And you can see if you're only applying for contracted transportation, if you put in an indirect cost rate, it's not gonna calculate anything for you because that's not something that's, contracted transportation is not something that's eligible to receive an indirect cost rate percentage. But if you were to put in something like staff salaries or something like that, if you know, if you're doing mobility management as well, then that would add up for you. So that's why it's important to use these proper categories when you're calculating these. So we actually get the correct amount you're asking for. And we don't have to go through and have that resubmitted or edited. All righty, let me go back to my presentation. Present. All right, I'm on slide 51. And this is the final call for questions. I know I owe Jane a follow-up. Can you review the different authorities, contracts versus certs and assurances? Jane, if I think I know what you're asking, if you're asking the authorities that kind of set forth these, here we go. Sorry, I'm finding my slide. I'm on slide 22. So the certs and assurances are provided by the FTA. They provide those to us for everyone to sign. The state master agreement and the project agreements are both provided by DRPT. So that's the authority for those two agreements. And those are once you've been awarded and your contract is executed. It's just something I wanted to mention as a sort of a process item that you need to have that authorized person identified as part of this process, if that makes sense. All right, I'm back on slide 51. Final call for questions. I know this was a very long presentation. Here we go. For Title VI requirements, are we required to publish language on transportation brochures, or will putting language on website be sufficient? So for brochures that are specifically for 5310 provided transportation, we do ask that you at least provide, even if it's a small indication of like we follow Title VI and ADA policies and procedures, something like that. And you know, you can then list the website or however you want to organize it. You don't need to publish your entire notice on your marketing materials. I know there's already very limited space on marketing materials, but please, if it is for 5310, do try to indicate somewhere, you know, we follow these non-discriminatory practices. It's important. Shortened statement, exactly. And of course, you can always direct them to the website for the full statement. Thank you. I'm going to go ahead and pull up my final screen, but I'm going to stick around here if any of you have any questions. I'm on slide 52. There's my email, my phone number, and I do want to take a moment to just note that going forward in the next couple of months, if you have questions for me and you want to schedule a call, I'd really prefer we try to schedule a call. I know sometimes you call me ad hoc. That's okay. I answer as I can. I just want you to know I am here. I just may need to schedule a call versus just answer it on the fly. And that it may take me a little longer than usual to answer emails. We're just getting into a busy time. We've got this new platform coming in. And I just want to set expectations that I really want to help you out and make sure all your questions get answered. But I just encourage you to look at that guidance, even talk to each other. And you know, see if you can find some answers, but if you can't, definitely reach out. Just know that I may be on a little bit of a delay. And I'm gonna go back to the chat here. So just to understand, if we're receiving funding to budget for other operating contracted service, it now must be on its own budget sheet without full-time. No, sorry, that's if you are applying to mobility management, you would include that on that budget sheet as well. So I didn't include it in that example just because I wanted to make it clear that contracted transportation needs to be on its own and not under operating. But if you're applying to mobility management, like staff salaries to do mobility management, yes, so everything on one sheet. So contractor transportation, mobility management are both considered other capital and are under one application, one budget. I just want to make sure it's distinguished from operating. So yes, everything on one sheet for any other capital projects. Okay, final note, just as we're here, more web grants training is incoming. Please be monitoring your emails for emails from that DRPT kind of .gov delivery email. We're gonna have a lot coming in for you guys, lots of materials, lots of trainings, and just want you all to be aware. But with that, I'm gonna go ahead and say thank you. If you'd like to head out, feel free, but I really appreciate you all coming out today. And if you have any questions, I'll be here for a few minutes. So thanks, Karen. Thanks, Kelsey. Thanks, Kathy. Thanks, Paula. Thanks, Melissa. How can we access the slides, Michelle? I will be sending them out. They should come in through the drpt.gov delivery email. So not necessarily directly from me, but through our kind of main email. And those, that will be coming out this week. Probably not today, but hopefully by tomorrow. I just have to get everything together and get that sent out. So you'll get those slides. Yep. Jess, when we receive the award contracts for FY24. So Deborah, those are your, I'm going to be sending out some communication about the FY24 contracts this week. That's something that we've been discussing a lot internally, and those should be coming out very soon, likely by the end of this week, but I'll be emailing everyone about those. Thanks, Ken. Thanks, Kim. Michael, can we set up a time to talk? Yes. Just email me. Thanks, Deborah. You too.